A very warm good morning to all the participants. I, WT, Assistant Professor, Department of E&CE, SVCE, Bengaluru. I would like to welcome for the day 5, session 9 of the AICTE-sponsored short-term training program, STTP, under AQIS program on optimization techniques for 5G cellular network from 13th to 18th July 2020. Organized by the Department of Electronics and Communication Engineering, Sri Venkateshwara College of Engineering, Bangalore, Karnataka. For the today's morning session, we have a keynote speaker, Professor Santosh Kumar S., Assistant Professor, Department of E&CE, SVCE, Bengaluru, on a research topic called as Massive MIMO System for 5G Technology. On behalf of management, principal, and from the head of the Department of Electronics and Communication Engineering, we welcome you for this event, sir. We welcome you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
I would like to introduce the resource speaker for the participants with a brief profile. Professor Santosh Kumar S. is currently working as an assistant professor in the Department of Electronics and Communication Engineering at Sri Venkateshwara College of Engineering, Bangalore. Sir received his BE degree in Electronics and Communication Engineering from SJCIIT Chikkaballapura in the year 2005 and earned his master's degree from MS Ramaiah Institute of Technology in 2009. Sir is currently registered and pursuing his PhD in digital signal processing using MIMO system from Visveshwaraya Technological University, Belagavi, Karnataka. The area of interest includes digital signal processing using DSP processors and statistical signal processing for speech applications, signals and system, wireless communication, digital signal compressions, and adaptive MIMO system. Several research proposals have been submitted under these streams to various prestigious bodies like AICTE, DST, VGST, IEEE, and KCST, and Sir has received funds. Recently, Sir has received a project fund from KCST and IEEE Bangalore section for the Innovative Idea category. Sir has been actively involved as a coordinator member in various committees like NBA, VTU, and NAC. Sir is passionate and eager to make the students ready for the industry. As an outcome of this, the department has conducted several workshops, seminars, and student development program in association with foreign universities. Sir has several publications in his credit in various prestigious journals. He has been IEEE RTICTE Internal Conference Coordinator since 2016 and has served as a jury reviewer for IEEE conferences. He has given many technical talks at various industries and institutions. With this brief introduction profile, I welcome you once again, sir, and request you to take over the session. Please, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Ravi, sir, for the nice introduction. Okay. So, good morning, all the participants. So just a second, I'll share the screen. So good morning, everyone, all the participants. So far you have learned yesterday about the many speakers have introduced regarding the 5G and its advantages and the security issues. So now today's session, I am going to introduce regarding the massive MIMO system. So for the 5G network and the recent trends and challenges. So I thank our HOD, the beloved HOD, Dr. Shushankar sir, for giving me an opportunity to present the seminar. And also I'll thank the management and the principal of Sri Venkateshwara College of Engineering. Okay, so the contents of my presentation are, so introduction, the evolution of the cellular networks, the challenges for the 5G technology, key enabling technologies for 5G, so massive MIMO, the challenges in the massive MIMO, and some system benefits and applications, and challenges and advantages. Okay, so let us come to the introduction. So nowadays you can see the requirement for the network is growing widely. It is being growing here because, as we know, because everyone needs a large data is required because of the COVID. So a lot of data is required by the person in order to fulfill the day-to-day requirements like scheduling the meetings, attending the classes for the school students, even the college students. So in order to fulfill these needs, so what the cellular network provider is doing is, so is they are deploying a lot of base stations they are deploying here. So you might have seen, nowadays, So in the early, before some 2018, the number of base stations in the town or in the any city, there were less number of town base stations were there because the requirement for the network congestion was less, and also the requirement for the network demand was less was there. Nowadays, because of the demand is growing large, so in order to fulfill that one, so the cellular network, the cellular areas have become very much complicated, very much conditioned here. So they're deploying a lot of base stations are deploying here. And also with the introduction of the some concepts such as the IoT and the machine to machine communications. So it is also contributing to increase the network traffic and usage of the mobile data in their day-to-day life here. So, and also in the future, in the 5G technology, so everyone wants the smart home they want here, and also they want augmented reality and ultra, everyone wants to download the very UHD videos I want to be downloaded here. So those are becoming very much popular here. So you can see the graph of how the number of the connected devices since from the 2016 to the 2022 is going. So nowadays we can see even if you are having mobile phone, we are going to connect with the laptop and we are going to connect with the TV, smart devices, many things we are going to connect here. So in the year 2016, it was a 2 per person was there, and about in the 2022, it may reach around 3.6 per person, it may reach here. And also here, the data traffic usage per the person has been defined here. But you can see in the 2016, the per person, they're using around the data of around 970 MB per month they're using here. But here it is, the graph is showing that by about 2022, okay, so 2022, the person is going to use a data rate of around 9.1 GB per month here. But I think this has been outdated here. So in the 2020 itself, we are using, per day itself, we are using the 2 GB of data we are using per person we are using. So in the month, almost we are using the 60 GB of internet we are using per month we are using here. Okay, so the network demand is growing very rapidly. So in order to fulfill these things, okay, so what the network service providers, they're practicing is that, so they're dividing the, they're densifying the network areas, and also they're into, they're building the, set up in the large number. Of base stations participated here. So increasing the bandwidth, which may result in the increasing the cost of the network service provider, because you know the communication channel bandwidth is very huge. It is a very costlier one. So if you increase the bandwidth, they need to buy the channels. So it is also increase the, it may increase the cost of the device, and also the latency of the device will increase here. And also, so in order to fulfill these demands, so okay, the massive, the 5G technology is going to be serve the purpose. Okay, which is going to fulfill the demands of the people's, such as a smart automation, smart so mobile to machine to machine communications. So the 5G will play a very important role by including the technology called the massive MIMO, that is massive multiple input input system. So which may be used in the 5G and the BI networks here. So let us go into the introduction of the evolution of the cellular networks. So many speakers in the last sessions might have covered the evolution of the cellular networks from 1G to the 6G. So just I'm going to touch the some of the key technical aspects and the key technologies that is going to be used in the 1G, 2G, 3G and the following cellular networks here. So you can see in the diagram, so here in the 1G, the voice calling has been introduced here. And here you can see in the 2G technology, along with the voice call, the SMS has been introduced. And in the 3G, the video calling, that is the net browsing has been increased. In the 4G, the video calling has been introduced. And 5G is going to call updated for the UHD, Ultra HD video has also been defined here. And 6G, so many more applications will be there in the 6G upcoming technology. Okay, so let us look into the some brief technical aspects of each and every generation here. So in the first generation of network has been introduced in the early in the year 1980s. So here they use the analog signals, they use it for the voice communication, and then some of the key technologies they use it is nothing but frequency division multiple access. With the data rate, it is supported up to the 2.4 kbps has been supported. But one of the drawback of this system is it is having the poor voice quality because of the eye interference, because of using the analog some modulation techniques or the analog communication techniques. And 1G system, it includes the, some of the technology called the advanced mobile phone system, which is called AMPS, and also the total access communication system and Nordic communication system, which is called NMTS here. So this is the first generation of the network. So coming to the second generation, so it is introduced in the year 1990s. Okay, so it is called as the digital version of the 1G network we are going to call. So in the 2G, along with the voice networks, the SMS has been added, and also some it is going to support the basic email has been supported in the 2G network here. and also some of the key digital techniques such as the code division multiple access and the trained division multiple access has been supported in the 2G network. And also it provides a data rate up to the 14.4 kbps, up to the 64 kbps has been provided. And also one of the popular technology, which is called as a GSM, Global System for Mobile Communication, as introduced in the 2G network, and still it is been using. And also the IS-95 CDMA technology has been included in the 2G spectrum. So, but 2G network is having the, so it's having a limited mobility, and also the hardware capability is limited to this one, because the users can't move from the one, it is the network, because of the hardware cost. So it is having the limited mobility as there. So upon move on to the 2G, so the upgraded version of the 2G, it is called the 2.5G and the 2.75G has been added here. So there they supported a data rate up to the 384 kbps has been supported. And the some internet has been introduced by using the technology called GPRS. And also they use the technology called Edge, and also the CDMA 2000 has also been introduced in the upgraded version of the 2G, which is called as the 2.5G and 2.75G network. Okay, so later in the earlier 2000s, the 3G network has been introduced. So by using the technology called GSM and CDMA, and also it supports the wide web browsing has been supported, and also the voice and MMS has been supported along with the SMS services. Okay, so and also it includes the 3G includes the technology called UMTS along with the WCDMA. So WCDMA is by using WCDMA, the data rate has been increased up to the, so around 384 kbps it has been introduced here. And because of the 3G technology, the smartphones have become very much popular in the mid of the 2000, and we were used extensively. The smartphones has been increased. Okay, and also it provides the data rate around 384 kbps. But the key problem with this one is the bandwidth requirement is more, and also it requires the complex infrastructure. So later after the 3G technology, so the new technology, that is the upgraded version of the 3G, which is called as the 3.5G, has been introduced here. And it is going to fulfill the requirements of the high data rates. And also they include the, for the downlink, they use the technology called high-speed downlink packet access. And for the uplink, high-speed uplink packet access, and also the high-speed HSPA plus has been introduced. And this is referred to as the upgraded version of the 3G, which is called as the 3.5G you're going to call. And it is going to provide the data rate up to the 2 Mbps has been supported in the 3.5G. Okay, so even though the 3.5G is provided with the higher data rate, but the cost of the equipment was costly, and also there's a compatibility issues will be there with respect to the 2G and with respect to the 3.5G, and that was a challenging gap. So later after the 3.5G, the new revolution has been come, that is called as the 4G. Okay, so 4G has been introduced in the early in the year 2010s, but practically it has been appeared in around in the market around 2040s. So the 4G is provide the data rate up to the 100 Mbps has been supported. So along with the quality of service is very good here. And the applications such as what we are using nowadays, such as video conferencing, online gaming, mobile television, so those become very much popular in the 4G technology. And also it's used the technology called WiMAX. And also the long-term evaluation has been introduced along with the advanced version of the long-term. It is called the LTE advanced. And this system is compatible with the older generation networks here. So like if you are using the LTE, it is also be compatible. It is going to serve for the GSM also. It is going to serve, and also the 3G technology also it has been served here. Okay. So, but for the 4G technology, the frequency bands are a bit expensive here. And also when there's a transition from the 3G to the 4G, whatever the 3G handsets were there, so those they are not supporting for the 4G. So the high-end mobile phones we need to be used, and we are using those things in order to operate with the 4G networks here. Okay, so these are some of the advantages of the 4G. And because of this 4G, so the cost of the data packet, like in early 3G, we are paying around, so for 1 GB, we are paying around 250 rupees, we are paying. So only if you remember the early olden days. But for 4G per day, we are getting 2 GB of data. We are getting at a cost of around 5 to 6 rupees we are getting here. That's an advancement in the 4G. Okay, that's a 4G technology. So later, the upcoming technology is called as a 5G technology. So it's a promising technology now to fulfill the requirement of the users. So it is going to offer the data rate up to the 100 times, which is going to be faster than that of the 4G network it is going to provide. And also, it is going to offer a data rate up to 10 Gbps. And also, it is going to provide the low latency it is going to provide. So it will be in terms of the milliseconds. So like the speed of the network will be, like the latency will be such a way that it is less than the blink of the human eye. And also, it is going to provide the, it is promising to provide the greater reliability. And also we can imagine that we can download the HD video. So within the few seconds, we can download that one because with a speed of around 10 Gbps, okay, it is possible to download an ultra HD movie. We can download within a very few seconds here. And also it is promising to support the some of the technology like smart home automation, smart home, so Internet of Things, and some smart devices it is going to support here. And these are some of the devices it is going to support. Like we are now with the 4G technology, we are accessing the cell phone, tablets we are accessing, and also we are accessing communicating with the broadband devices. So the 5G is going to promise the smart cars, it is going to provide the smart home automation system, and even it is going to connect the stadiums and also the smart watches. It is now connecting with the 4G technology itself. Okay, so these are some of the promises that is the 5G technology is doing, which is going to offer the huge data rate, and also the latency is very less, and also the quality of service will be very good it is offering here. Okay, so behind that one, let us see what are the challenges present in the 5G technology. Okay, so in the 5G technology, as it is promising the huge data rate, but whatever the existing frequency bands are there, so the existing frequency bands we are using for the 4G communication is, it's 6G, it is around 6G, less than the 6 gigahertz we are using here. So, but for the 5G technology, so we need to use the band, frequency band up to the 300 gigahertz has to be used here. But using this frequency band, it's not very simple. It's a very costlier one. And it has to be paid in terms of millions of rupees. It has to be paid for the frequency band.
Just wait a minute, because of some network issues, I think sir has been logged out. Santosh sir, so sorry for the inconvenience. I think sir has been joined.
There will be a chance of attacking man's location tracking and also the west tracking will be there here. Okay. Hello, sir. Voice is audible, right? Okay, sir. Okay. Okay, sir. Okay. And also the availability. So in the 5G technology, Since it's a promising for the lot of things like mobile to mobile communication, so the Internet of Things, because of these things, the network will getting more overloaded and the congestion will be increased because of connecting the these devices. So still the network 5G is promising for the huge bandwidth and huge data rate. So I think this availability will not come into so much. It's not a problem. It will be not much difficult one here. Okay, so the cybercrime, which is a lot of things, the tribal laws has to be made in order to prevent the cybercrime. So, which is one of the key security issues will come here. Okay, so let us see what are the key enabling techniques for the 5G here. So, in the 5G, some of the key enabling techniques are something called millimeter waves. Okay, the small cells and the beam forming. So, device center architecture, the full duplex technology, the terahertz wave and the visible light spectrum and the massive MIMO. So these are the key enabling technologies which is going to support the 5G. So in order to deliver the huge data rate and the huge bandwidth which will be provided here. Let us look into these things, these aspects. So let us see what are the pros and cons of these technologies we are having here. So let us move to the millimeter waves here. So for the existing cellular networks, so what the frequency bands we are using is we are using the frequency bands less than the 6 GHz we are using here. So that is for the 6 GHz, that is frequency bands we are using. And the frequency above the 6 GHz, okay, so usually it is used for the applications such as some medical imaging, microwave remote sensing, and amateur radio and radio astronomy. These are things it will be using here. So, but for the 5G technology, so in order to, since it is promising the huge data rate, so with the frequency range around 6 GHz, it may not support the so much of data rate here. So it is required to use the frequency more than the 6 GHz. So that frequency, it is called as the frequency from the 30 GHz to the 300 GHz, it is called as a millimeter wave you are going to call here. So these frequencies, usually it will be called millimeter. Why? Because the wavelength of this one will be in terms of the 1 to 10 millimeter will be there when compared to the existing radio waves, what we are using for the current mobile communication here. Okay, so for the current mobile communication, the frequency, the wavelength will be in terms of the 10 centimeters will be there. Okay, so it is called as a millimeter. Why? Because the wavelength will be in terms of 1 to the 10 millimeter will be there. Oh, since it is having a 30 gigahertz to 300 gigahertz will be there. So these are the waves which cannot, the drawback of this one is that these waves are the shorter wavelengths will be there. And these wavelengths cannot propagate for the longer distance here. And also it is not possible to propagate the, so buildings and obstacles, it is not possible to propagate. And also because of the some rain or because of the some atmospheric conditions, the waves may get absorbed in the rain or because of the thunderstorm, the waves will not get propagated. That's one of the drawback of this millimeter wave. But if you, by using the millimeter, so we can able to obtain the large bandwidth will be obtained. So you can see from the 30 gigahertz to 300 gigahertz, we can able to obtain the bandwidth of around 270 gigahertz bandwidth will be able to obtain here. Okay, so that's one of the advantage, and the disadvantage is that, so it cannot penetrate for the longer buildings and also obstacles. It cannot penetrate. Okay, so and it will be absorbed by the waveforms. Okay, that's one of the drawback will be there. And you can see the microwaves, the frequency range of the different waves will be seen here. The microwaves will be having the frequency up to the some 30 gigahertz will be there. And the millimeter, the frequency will be from 30 gigahertz up to the 300 gigahertz will be there. And above the 300 gigahertz up to the 3 terahertz, it is called as a terahertz wave you're going to call here. Okay, so these are the pros and cons of the millimeter waves. The other one is nothing but it is also called as a sub-millimeter wave you're going to call, or it is also called as a terahertz band. Okay, so the frequency from 30 to 300 gigahertz, it is called millimeter wave, so which is proposed for the current 5G technology. And so for the some technologies like for the 6G or even for the 5G, they can using the frequency bands from 300 gigahertz to the 3 terahertz is going to be used here. Okay, so since in the industry, a lot of research is going in the wireless communication industry in order to use this frequency band. Okay, the advantage of this frequency band is that it is having the, it is interference friendly, and also it provides the security, and also we can scalability is possible with this one, and also the low power consumption will be there, and also the size of the antenna will reduce drastically, and also it is possible to obtain the focus beams also possible to obtain here. And the terahertz technology one is one of the key applications in the industry 4.0, and also it may use it for the applications such as the imaging spectroscopy and holographic transparency, it can be used here. So, but the problem with the terahertz frequency band is that so the deployment of the antennas will become much more complicated, and also the antenna should be have the high transmitting gain, and also the more complexity circuit design is required. So where there is a lot of propagation loss will be there, and also the mobility will become challenging in the with respect to the terahertz band here. Okay, so let us move on to the next technology, which is called small cells and heterogeneous networks. So as I told earlier, so since in the 5G network, we are going to use the millimeter wave technology. So as the millimeter wave, it cannot propagate for the longer distance. So that's why the whatever the existing cell technology is there, it is required to divide those cells into the smaller regions, which may be up to the 100 meter distance we need to deploy the antennas is need to be deployed here. And okay, so with the this deployment, since it is going to cover only the 100 meters, so we can, the advantage is that we can make use of the low power base stations we can use, so that we can prevent the signal from dropping in the crow radius. We can deploy here, so we can avoid it here. And also by using the millimeter waves, so instead of the existing 6 gigahertz wave, we can have the smaller size, cell size we can possible, and also be fitted in the tiny places. Also, we can be fitted here. And also, it is a chance of dividing the small cells into the further into the micro cells, femoral cells, and the pico cells. And the based on the coverage area, the number of users, and it can be divided into the these cells. It can be divided here. So this is one of the advantage where we can divide the big cell into the smaller cells. But in the meantime, there is a lot of disadvantages. It may increase the network cost because of having the lot of base stations need to be deployed, and a lot of the circuit complexity will also increases here. Okay, so let us move on to the beamforming. So beamforming is one of the, it's a key technology for the 5G massive MIMO technology. So here we are going to use some advanced antenna technologies will be used, so that it is going to focus the beam in the particular direction, so that the user will get the good data rate, and good bandwidth will be possible to obtain for the user here. So usually the beamforming is a technology, it will be used for a downlink, that is transmitting the data from the base station to the mobile station. So the beamforming technology will be used here. So what the beamforming will be done is, so it is going to transmit the signal focusing on the user. The beamform, it is going to transmit the high energy signal will be transmitted to the particular user, it will be transmitted here. And it is going to reduce the some interference with the nearby user. It is going to be reduced by using the beamforming technology. And for the massive MIMO with the beamforming, which helps to increase the efficiency, and also for the millimeter wave technology, it helps to boost the data rate here. Okay, so in the massive MIMO systems, what happens here? So the base station can send the data in the various paths. It can the base station can send data to the user in the various paths it can send here. So, but the beamforming is going to focus the beam only towards the particular user. It is going to focus here. So with the beamforming, it is possible to use the shorter wavelength for the longer distance, and also by using the concentrated beams, the user can get the high data rate it is possible to obtain here. Okay, so that's one of the advantage of the beamforming. Beamforming combined with the massive MIMO will provide the huge data rate, and also the user will be having the low latency will be there, and the high data rate and high bandwidth is possible to obtain by using the beamforming technology. Okay, so let us move on to the device center architecture. So what the current existing technology, the 4G system is using is, it is going to use the something called the base station center architecture it is using here. So where the device is going to send the downlink and uplink connections will be controlled by the base station. In the major advantage of the 5G network is that, so in the 5G network, there will be a lot of transmitting antennas will be there, and a lot of receivers will be there, the number of antennas will increase, and also the cell density will increase, and the base station density will also increase here. So in order to fulfill that one, so the architecture, instead of having the base center, the base station center architecture, so the architecture has to be moved on to the device centric architecture has to be moved, so that the user device would communicate with the exchange the information with the several heterogeneous nodes which is possible to exchange here. So that's one of the key technology which is planning for the 5G network here. So other one is the full duplex technology. So this is one of the key technology where in the wireless communication, the present wireless communication, they're going to use the different bands will be used for the uplink as well as for the downlink data transmission here. So since in order to avoid the interference between the uplink and downlink, there we are using the transmitting the data at the different frequency bands we are going to use here. So in order to fulfill the data requirement, so the bidirectional transmission of the data has to be used. The bidirectional transmission of the data has to be used in the separate links, so that they'll be having a no interference will be there with the signals. And also in order to transmit the signals, we're supposed to use the non-interfering orthogonal signals has to be used here. So in the 5G networks, since it is promising for the huge data, so it is possible, it is required to use the full duplex technology, so that both the transmission and the receiving of the signals, which increase which double the network capacity, and also it is going to double the data transmission, it is going to double here. But one of the disadvantage with the full duplex technology is that it increases the signal interference through some psi echo, it is going to increase here. That's one of the drawback of the full duplex technology. But the advantage is that it is going to provide the huge data rate it is going to provide here. That's the advantage for the full duplex technology. So the next key technology is the it's a visible light communication. So usually the visible light communication, it's not popular in the 4G, but it is going to be popular. It is expecting to be popular in the 5G era. So in the visible light communication, so it is going to provide the bandwidth similar to the optical fiber it is going to provide here. So it is going to provide the huge bandwidth will be provided. So in the visible light, what we are going to use is we are going to use the LED and the fluorescent lamps we are going to use, and which is going to support the huge bandwidth, which will be in terms of from 400 to the 800 terahertz frequency band will be used by the support of the LEDs and the fluorescent lamps here. So usually, this is going to be supported in the unlicensed frequency band, and also with the use of the existing lights can be replaced by the LEDs. So which is going to support the transmission of the data, it will be supported, and that's one of the advantage here. And also since we are using the LEDs for the transmission of the data, so there will be no electromagnetic radiations will be there here. Okay, so and also there is no extra electromagnetic radiations from the other devices also not be there. So here what we are going to use is LED, since it is this visible light communication can be possible to use only for the indoor applications, and also some of the technologies will be defined by the IEEE standards like IEEE 802.115.7, like 3G partnership generation. It is going to support for the visible light communication, but it is not used in the existing cellular networks. Okay, so this VLC will be helpful in the 5G technology, and also it may be one of the key technology for the 6G networks here. Okay, so with this one, within the indoor, the user can able to connect with the existing LEDs and can provide the get the high data rate is possible to obtain by using the visible light communication here. Okay. So the next key technology for the 5G is nothing but it's a massive multiple input, multiple input output system here. So multiple input, multiple output is nothing but we are going to use the lot of transmitters and the lot of receivers we are going to use here. That is called as a multiple input, multiple output we are going to call. And it is going to promise the capacity of the radio link, and also it is going to increase the data rate of the transmission will be increases here. So usually the signal will be transmitting in the multipath. It is going to make use of the multipath propagation it is going to make use. And also in the existing technology, the MIMO is not going to be used so much. So where MIMO, they're going to use a 2x2 MIMO will be used. So which is going to provide the high spectral efficiency and energy efficiency will be possible by increasing the number of transmitting and the receiving antennas here. Okay. So in the before the MIMO, whatever the MIMO is there, so there it was a single input and single output systems are there. So where we have the one base station, the number many number of users will be there. So it is not going to support it is not supporting such so much of large number of users, and also the reliability was less was there here. But in the 5G network, it is planning to use the massive MIMO will be used, where the large number of transmitting and the receiving antennas will be there. And also it is possible to obtain the massive data traffic. It is possible to be possible to obtain with the high speed is possible here. So let us look into the some of the MIMO types. Okay, so the some of the MIMO types are nothing but it's a single input, single output, and a single user MIMO. So where in the single output, one transmitter, one receiver will be there. And a single user MIMO, so some two transmitter, two receivers will be there. And multi-users, many transmitters and many receivers will be there. And CMO, that is a single input, multiple output. So one transmitter and the many receivers will be there. These are some of the classification of the MIMO types here. So, but in the massive MIMO, we are going to, it is planned to use a lot of number of transmitting antennas and a lot of number of receiving antennas will be used in the massive MIMO. Okay. So this massive MIMO, this is the current existing conventional MIMO. So where it is going to support the transmitting antennas, these are nothing but the transmitting antennas and these are nothing but the receiving antennas. So it can support up to the 2 to 8 transmitting antennas will be supported. And that's it will be used in the key that is LTE-A technology, advanced technology. So in the massive MIMO, so it is going to be promised to support the antennas more than the 100 to the 1000 it is going to support here. So each base stations will be equipped with the lot of transmitting antennas. So these antennas is going to communicate with the user equipments. So n number of user equipments it is going to communicate here. This is one of the key technology of the 5G network, where the multiple transmission and multiple receptions will take place here. Okay. And in the currently existing technology, something called 802.11. So that is used in the Wi-Fi is going to use the MIMO technology, and also the advanced version of the Wi-Fi, which is called 802.11 AC, and HSP and WiMAX and LTE is using the current MIMO technology. But in the massive MIMO, so large number of antennas and the receivers will be there. That's one of the key technology for the 5G networks here. So let us look into the why we need how the massive uplink and downlink will be there. So in case of the massive MIMO, the here also we're going to use the same hexagonal cell structure will be used here. And this is in case of the uplink where the mobile stations, many mobile stations or the user equipment is going to communicate with the lot of base stations. So the base stations will be having a lot of transmitting and receiving antennas will be there. And during the downlink, the transmitter is going to use the beamforming technology now to use the focused beam towards the user so that it can possible to achieve the high data rate is possible to achieve in case of the downlink here. So this uplink and downlink technologies, it's using for the 5G network. And you can see by using the beamform technology during the downlink, we can see the structure of the cell here. So this is the 4x4 array where using the 4 transmitting and the 4 receiving antennas will be there. So since the antennas are less, the beam is wider beam is using here. So if the number of transmitting and receiving antennas are using, so they're going to use a more focused beam, it is being used, and also the dimension of the beam it will be reducing here. And if you look into the 32x32, so still the more focused beams you are using. And if the number of antennas will increase, still the beams will become more focused and it will be propagate within the desired frequency bands and will reach the user equipment with the faster rate and provides the high data rate it is going to provide. So these are how the beamforming technology will be used during the downlink and which will increase the network capacity and will increase the high data rate possible for the user equipment here. Okay. So during the uplink transmission, so what will be done is, so here it consists of the decoder will be there and the base stations will be there. The base stations will be equipped with the M number of base stations will be there and there are N number of users will be there. And N number of users will communicating simultaneously with the M number of base stations it is going to communicate here. So there's a chargeable of the communication, the channel between the user and the base stations will be having a matrix of M cross N will be there. So this is a matrix we are going to call it as a channel state information we are going to call here. So the one user can communicate with the multiple transmitting antennas. So the received by the one antenna, the signal received by the one antenna will be in terms of the signal received by all the users along with the some interference signal and also some the delayed signal from the because of the obstacles it may receive by the base station here. Okay, so probably the expected signals received by one base station will be equal to it will be in terms of c to the power of n will be there. So where n is nothing but the number of user equipments. So along with that one, so the delayed version of the signals also been received by the base station. So a lot of the signal processing technology has to be allocated in order to overcome the effect of something called multipart fading and also in order to overcome the losses. So that's why the decoder has been used here. So in order to overcome these things here, this is in case of the uplink transmission. And similarly, in case of the downlink transmission, okay, so usually the transmitter is going to transmit the multiple signals to the one transmitter is going to transmit the multiple signals to the N number of users it is going to transmit here. And also it is going to use the M number of pilot signals will be used here. And during the downlink, what happens? The M number of base stations will be there and the N number of mobile stations will be there as the user equipment will be there. So there also the signal received by the user, it will be depends upon the M number of base stations it is going to receive. For example, the user one is going to receive the signal from the antenna one, the base station two, and also the M base station also it is going to use here. So that there will be a lot of signal processing operations it will be required by the user in order to overcome the losses and also in order to overcome the interference here. Okay, so these are how the uplink will be done and how the downlink will be done. And let us see why the massive MIMO is important for the 5G transmission. Because with the 5G transmission, so it's one of the research, artist research topic in the 5G is the thing that it's a massive MIMO here. So because of the massive MIMO, it is possible to double, multiply the available bandwidth or the available data rate, it is possible to multiply here. So a lot of research has been going on in the industry. So the research has been conducted by the London University in the along with the Bristol University in the year 2015. So which they achieved the data rate of around 145.6 bits per second per hertz has been achieved with the spectral efficiency of around 22 users. Okay, and also they use something modulation technique called 256 QAM has been used here, and also at the frequency rate of around 3.51 gigahertz has been used with the 128 antennas. And also they set up the device. This is a device which has been generated by the Lund University. So with the 100 massive antennas will be tested here. And it has supported the increased data rate, which compared to the previous existing one with the 3 bits per second, it has been achieved here. Okay. So this massive MIMO is required in order to multiply the data rate in order to provide the better efficiency. So the massive MIMO is required here. Let us see what are the challenges that is with the massive MIMO. And let us see what are the mitigation techniques we can use for the, it is proposed for the this massive MIMO here. So the some of the challenges is nothing but the pilot contamination, the user scheduling, so hardware impairments will be there, pre-coding, the channel estimation, and signal detection. So these are the challenges that is present in the massive memo. So let us see, look into the each and every one. Let us see what is the things will be there. So the pilot contamination. So usually what happens, so this is a cell structure which is being defined. So one where the base station will be there and the many number of mobile stations will be there. And in the neighboring cell, there also they're going to have the mobile stations along with the base stations will be there. So usually what happens, so usually the mobile phone is going to send the pilot signal, that is called as the orthogonal pilot signal, is going to be sent by the mobile user to the base station. So in order to, in the, that is in the uplink channel, it is going to send here. So the base station, in order to find the estimate the downlink channel, it is going to use one of the concept called the channel reciprocity property. It is going to be used, okay, in order to estimate the downlink channel towards the terminal here. So since so whenever the each and every mobile user want to communicate with the base station, this is a procedure it is going to take place here. So that is the pilot signal will be transmitted from the user to the base station, and the base station is going to send the orthogonal pilot signal will be transmitted from the base stations by using the channel reciprocity property to the mobile station in order to find out the downlink channel here. So since the cells are placed one after the other, and also the number of pilot orthogonal pilot signals are it's a fixed one, and it is a less number will be there. So what are the set of pilot signals will be used by the one base station, one cell? The same set of pilot signals will be may also be used in the other cells will be used here. For example, if the in order to find the downlink channel, if the assume that this is a user phone, it will be there. So if the user phone, that is the if the base station sends the pilot signal to the user, and if the neighboring cell also using the same orthogonal pilot signal will be used here. So at that time, the base station, this base station may receive the linear combination of the channel response related to the this cell. Also the neighbor cell also it is going to be received here. So that one you're going to call it as the pilot contamination you're going to call here. So this pilot contamination is going to encounter because of using the same orthogonal pilot signal by the this cell and also the neighboring cell. And because of that one, it may receive the characteristics of the same cell along with the neighboring cell also increase here. So this one you're going to call it as a pilot contamination. So this pilot contamination will affect during the downlink when the base station transmitting the data to the user. So there the problem will arises and it may reduce the throughput of the device. It will be reduced here. Okay. So that's the problem of the pilot contamination. So because of the using the same set of orthogonal signals in the cell and the neighbor cell here, that's one of the problem will be there here. So and the next one is nothing but channel estimation here. So usually in order to transmit the signal between the base station and the mobile station, so the channel estimation will play a very important role. So it contains the information regarding the channel, something called the effect of the fading and scattering. Many factors will be present in the channel state information here. Okay, so if the channel state information is perfect one, so then the performance of the massive MIMO systems will increase with respect to the transmitting and receiving intensity will increase here. But whatever the channel state information is there, so that is it is not perfect one will be there because of the wireless communication is it depends on the atmospheric effects like rain, thunderstorm, and also the lightning effect. So it is going to change here. So in order to obtain the channel state information, what the procedure is doing is they are going to use a two different duplex technologies will be used. One is called as a frequency division duplexing, other one is called as a time division duplexing is going to be used here. So in order to find the in order to get the channel state information for the downlink, what will be done is, so usually user equipment, as I told in the pilot contamination, user equipment is going to send the orthogonal pilot signal to the base station. So by using the channel reciprocity property, the base station is going to send the information, and by using that one, it is going to find out the downlink. It is going to obtain the channel state information for the downlink. It is going to obtain here. Okay. So for the massive MIMO systems, since there are many transmitting antennas will be there and many receiving antennas will be there, so the downlink channel estimation in case of the FTD will becomes very much complicated here. So and also it will be implemented, it is difficult to implement in the real world applications. So what happens in order to find the downlink channel estimation for the FTD, so usually they're going to use the TDD technology they're going to use here. So here the TDD technology, what they're using is they're using the same principle called the channel reciprocity theorem. So once the base station receives a signal from the mobile user equipment, so by using the channel reciprocity theorem, it is going to estimate the downlink. It is going to be estimated here. Okay, but using this channel state information, so what happens here is that since as I told in the pilot contamination, If there is a same set of information, same set of signals will be used in the one cell and the neighboring cell. So this may be a problem will be there in the get the channel state information here. That is the pilot contamination will may reduces the, which may get the duplicate transmission in channel state information will be obtained here. That's one of the key challenging in the massive MIMO technology in order to obtain the, that is the channel state information because of the pilot contamination. So recently in order to overcome this one, there are many algorithms that has been developed here, such as called as some algorithms called low complexity, that is a least square algorithm, and a linear minimum mean square error algorithm, and also the which is going to provide the better accuracy. So in the channel estimation, but also the complexity will be increases with the more number of antennas here. So and also the massive MIMO system which uses a TD operation. So since a lot of research is going on in using the FDD for the massive MIMO systems here. So this is the channel state information, getting the channel state information will be a problem in case of the pilot contamination. So this topic is one of the key research area in the finding the channel state information. So the other one is called pre-coding here. So usually the pre-coding concept will be combined with the beamforming here. So in order to support the multi-transmission, multi-stream antennas, that will be used by using the pre-coding technology. So usually the pre-coding will play a very important role in along with the beam forming in the transmission of the signal, and also the overcome the effects such as called as a path loss and also the interference, and also it is going to maximize the throughput here. So what happens in the massive MIMO system? So based on the channel state information, so as I told, the channel state information is going to be very depending on the, in the wireless communication because of the imperfect, non-perfect, because of the varying characteristics of the atmosphere here. So if the channel state information is perfect, and also the, if the number of, if the pre-coding technology by combining the effect of the channel state information and by using the pre-coding, so the downlink can be achieved, very good downlink rate can be achieved, and also the performance of the system can also be increased here. So, but what happens here is, the performance of the downlink systems, it depends on the channel state information and the pre-coding technique applied here. So because of imperfect channel state information, so there may be a loss of information will be there here. So in the literature, a lot of pre-coding techniques have been developed here. So in order to reduce the loss of data, so there are some many linear and non-linear pre-coders has been developed, it has been proposed here. So some non-linear pre-coders are nothing but it's a dirty paper pre-coding and Tomlinson Ashima pre-coding and a vector perturbation. So these are which is I'm going to provide the better computation, but the drawback of this one is that if the computational complexity of this one is large, and also it is going to be increases along with the antenna size here. And also some of the linear pre-coders has also been proposed here. So those are nothing but something called maximal ratio combining and zero forcing regularized pre-coder, and also the water filling and the MMSE, that is the minimum mean square error, which is having the low computational complexity, and also the better performance will be achieved with these linear pre-coders. Okay, so the next one is the user scheduling here. So user scheduling will play a very important role when the number of transmitting antennas is less when compared to the number of users will be there. So usually what happens, since there are a lot of antennas will be there with respect to the base station, and these it is going to communicate with the users simultaneously. And when it is going to communicate simultaneously, the base station with one base station is going to communicate with the n number of users simultaneously, it is going to communicate here. So during the communication, so there will be interference will be there between the this communication will be there, and also it may degrade the performance of the system here. So but by using the pre-coding technique along with the by using the pre-coding technique, so it is possible to obtain the high data rate is possible to obtain. But it is the user scheduling is required when if the number of transmitting antennas is less when compared to the number of users will be there. That is, if the number of users are much more when compared to the number of transmitting antennas, so there the user scheduling is required here. So that's what the user scheduling algorithm is used before the pre-coding in order to obtain the better throughput and also increase the sum rate performance here. Okay. So some of the user scheduling, a lot of research is going on in optimizing this user scheduling algorithms. Some of the linear methods has been proposed, something called the zero forcing equalizer and MMSC. So which is going to provide the optimal throughput, and also it is going to increase the computational complexity. Okay, it is going to improve the performance, but it is also having the some acceptable computational complexity will be there. And some of the non-linear methods are there, something called as called dirty paper coding, and also the maximum likelihood coding, and provides the optimal performance is there. but it is having the these nonlinear methods is having the higher computational complexity out there here. And also the some of the popular existing computational algorithms such as called Round-Robin algorithm, proportional fail algorithm, and also the greedy algorithm. So it is guarantees for the fairness among the user, but these algorithms has to be tested for the 5G network in presence of the large number of transmitting antenna and the receiving antenna. Okay, so these are the some of the research challenges that is present in case of the scheduling algorithms when the number of users are there. So this is one of the key research area, and hardware impedance. So in the massive MIMO, as it is told, so a lot of transmitting antennas will be there and a lot of receiving antennas will be there in the case of the massive MIMO. So here, when they are installing the lot of transmitting antennas, the cost of the devices will increase here. So in order to reduce the cost of the device, they may use the some low cost small equipments can be used, but they reduce the cost here. But those devices may increase the computational complexity. It is going to be increased by those devices here. So because of using the low cost components, so some of the problems will increase here. Those problems are nothing but hardware impedance. So those are nothing but something called phase noise, IQ imbalance, amplifier distortion, the magnetization noise. So these are some of the things will be it is chance of getting. These impedance will be there in case of the 5G networks. So it is not possible to overcome these impedance totally, but by using some of the technologies that is called as by using the compensation algorithms. So these are the problems, these are the hardware problems can be overcome by using some of the compensation algorithms here. So it's one of the drawback of the 5G technology. And energy efficiency. So energy efficiency is nothing but it's a ratio of the spectral efficiency and the transmitter power. So usually the spectral efficiency depends upon the number of transmitting antennas and the number of receiving antennas. So since in the massive MIMO, so a lot of transmitting antennas are going to be used here, the spectral efficiency will be very good. The spectral efficiency will be there because of incorporating the lot of n number of transmitting antennas, the spectral efficiency will be more. But since we are using the lot of n number of transmitting antennas will be there, there is a chance of using the transmission power, that is the power consumption by the antennas will be more will be there here. So many studies has been carried out in order to build the energy efficient massive MIMO systems, that is which are going to save the power consumption along with the providing the spectral efficiency also here. Okay, so some of the low complex and low cost methods for the pre-coding detection and channel estimations has been proposed in order to reduce the power consumption by the device. And also the lot of research is going on, okay, on the antenna and the power amplifier and the design of the power amplifier in order to reduce the power consumption of the system here. Okay, so this is one of the energy efficiency will play a very important role here. And other one is nothing but in the signal detection. So this signal detection problem will be arises during the uplink process. So when the multiple users are transmitting the signal to the transmitting antennas, that is to the base stations. So there, the lot of signals will be there from the one user to the, there is a multipath faded signal and also delayed signals will be there from the user equipment to the base station antenna. So all the signals at the base station will be superimposed at the base station, which may create the interference. And also the signal problem, detection problems will become increases. And also it may reduce the efficiency of the signal. And also it may reduce the throughput. It is going to be reduced here. So some of the there are some convectional non-detects like something called spear decoder and successive interference calculations. They're promising to yield a good performance, but along with the performance, there is a chance of increasing the computational complexity and also the more number of antennas. Because of the more number of antennas, the computational complexity will also increase here. So some of the linear precoders has been proposed, which is called as a maximum likelihood precoder, and the zero forcing equalizer and MMS equalizer has been proposed for the this in order to overcome the effect of the signal detection. Okay, so these are the some of the problems that is present in the 5G technology, so which is plays very important role in order to, and these are a lot of research has been happening in order to overcome these problems here. So let us see whether can we make use of our current mobile phones in the massive MIMO technology. So whatever the mobile phones we are using, so that mobile phones cannot support the massive MIMO because so these phones are not equipped with the MIMO systems. Even though if you buy a phone, smartphone, which is going to have the MIMO system, but the network has to provide the this massive MIMO network has to be support. So in order to get the benefit of this MIMO system here. Okay, so the phones which are equipped with the MIMO technology, so which is going to have the higher data rate will be there, and also having the good reliability will be there. So nowadays, some of the phones come with the 4x4 MIMO systems, And also they offer the data rate, which will be much double when compared to the 2x2 MIMO systems will be there. Okay, so which is having a two transmitting and the two antennas will be there. So some of the phones which are currently available in the market, which are nothing but the iPhone XR, iPhone X and iPhone 11. So these are the phones which is equipped with the 2x2 MIMO. Okay, and also some of the phones like iPhone 11 Pro, iPhone 11 Pro Max, iPhone XS Max, and Samsung and Google Pixel and HTC and Huawei Mate. So these are the phones which are equipped with the 4x4 MIMO systems will be there. So what are the phones we are going to buy? But the problem is that the network has to support for this MIMO so that we can achieve the better data rate and also the high reliability it is possible to achieve here. Okay, so this machine learning. Okay, so we can include the concept of machine learning and deep learning in the massive MIMO systems here. So usually the machine learning is it's a subset of the artificial intelligence which will be used for the classification and the prediction problem, and also the deep learning also is used for the as a universal classifier and also the approximate the general functions here. So this machine learning combined with the deep learning can be used in the massive MIMO systems, like in the machine learning can be used here. So in order to, during the operations such as the beamforming operation, the channel estimation and the signal detection and load balancing operations. So this MIMO machine learning can be equipped with this thing so that which can reduce the complexity of the device, it can be reduced. And also the computational complexity will reduce by the usage of this machine learning and the deep learning here. Okay, and also along with that one, some of the existing methods like the traditional method like stochastic geometry and the game theory is the research is going on this one in the usage of the this technology in the massive MIMO. So that's a machine learning will play a very important role in the optimization of the computational calculations in the these fields here. Okay. So some of the benefits of the massive MIMO systems are it is going to provide the high spectral efficiency is going to provide because it is having the large number of transmitting and receiving antennas will be there and array gain. So since the beamforming technology will be used, the gain will be much more will be there and high energy efficiency. Okay, so a lot of research will be going on in this one and also the high data rate is possible and also it is possible to track the user and low power consumption will be there and the fading will be less because of the using the beamforming technology and latency will be in terms of very less will be there. It is less than the human eye blink because of using the high speed beamforming device, and it is having the more reliability will be there. And in the meantime, it is having the lot of challenges. Those challenges we have discussed here. So those are nothing but the pilot contamination. So the channel estimation, the pre-coding, user scheduling, and hardware impedance, energy efficiency, and signal detection. So these are the some of the challenges we have come across so far. Okay. So let us see what are the challenges and what are the mitigation techniques can be used. So in the pilot contaminations, so the some of the algorithms like pilot based estimation, subspace based estimation, pilot reuse, partial sounding resource, pilot contamination pre-coding and blind pilot decontamination, pilot decontamination and disturbed non-orthogonal pilot signals. So these are the some of the technologies that can be applied in order to overcome the effect of the pilot contamination. And similarly, in case of the channel estimation, so these are the algorithms will play very much a crucial role. And a lot of research is going on in the applying these algorithms. So like least square MMSE and improved MMSE and blind estimation, complex sensing and untrained deep neural network and complex sensing, convolution blind denoising. And these are some of the algorithms, research is going on these algorithms in the estimation of the channel estimation. And the pre-coding. So some of the pre-codings have already been discussed. It's a zero forcing equalizer and MMSE, dirty paper coding. And these are the some of the pre-coding techniques. The research is going on and it is going to promising for providing the better coding, pre-coding will be promising here. And the advantages of the 5G are, it is going to provide the huge data rate it is going to provide with the around 10 Gbps. And also the data rate will be much more than when compared to the 4G network. And latency, the latency of this one is very less in terms of the 1 millisecond when compared to the 5G networks. And also it is going to provide the efficient signaling and where that it is possible of IoT connectivity is also possible along with the machine to machine communication is also possible. And also user experience, so user can experience the augmented reality and also the virtual reality and also the artificial intelligence it is possible to obtain. And spectral efficiency, so the spectral efficiency will be much more. It will be 10 times more than the spectral efficiency that is used for the 4G networks. Okay. And also the energy efficiency, it will be 5G networks will be 90% more efficient when compared to the existing 4G networks. And it is possible to ubiquitous connections. So it is possible to connect the number of devices possible to connect with the 5G networks here. And also the battery life, 5G provides almost 10 times the battery life of the existing powered life for the IoT device it is going to provide. So these are the lot of advantages of for the 5G technology. But in the meantime, the lot of research challenges is also there in order to fulfill the requirement of the 5G. Okay, so let us look into the video how the 5G network will be there. Okay, so this I'm going to play the video.
Santosh sir, audio is not audible sir. No sir.
Is it audible sir?
Yes sir.
So thank you everyone. Thank you sir. Okay.
Thank you sir. It was very informative from the Department of Electronics and Communication Engineering, and from the management and the principal, sir, we would once again like to thanks for the Professor Santosh Kumar, sir, for accepting our invitation and gracing the event. Thank you, sir. I request all the participants, we have posted the feedback link in the chat box. I kindly request all the participants to fill the feedback form. And if there is any queries, means you can ask the queries. Once again, I am requesting all the participants kindly give their feedback for the morning session, and a gentle reminder for the afternoon session. We have a Dr. Keshamurthy sir, professor and a COE, controller of examination from the Department of Electronics and Communication Engineering, will be giving you the session. So I request all the participants kindly join for the afternoon session.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.